Wow, what an intro. So our intro for our show is by Margaret Ray, and the song is Get Back, and it's off her album Habit. So if you have a chance, please check out that song. So anyways, good evening, everyone. Thank you for joining us. This is Common Ground Radio. We are a Days of Our Lives discussion show where we dish on all the latest in Salem, USA. I am your host, Brandon, and on the line with us is my co-host, Misty.
Good afternoon, everyone.
Are you ready? Are you excited?
Yes, I'm very excited.
Okay, well, first off, let me start off by saying, give a little background on last week's show, or last week's shows, I should say. So last week on Days, Marge had news that affects Sammy's case. Adrian was at her wit's end. Can her marriage to Justin be salvaged? A catfight ensued at the DeMiro mansion, and someone is thrown out. And Chad gets an answer from his specialist. Was Cameron right for Rory, or is Chad in the clear? So, based on that, we can already tell that a lot happened last week. And we'll get right into the week that was in Salem in just a moment. But first, Misty and I would like to thank the creator of Air Nation Radio, Dawn, for giving us this wonderful opportunity to join the Air Nation Radio Network. We're excited to see where this leads, and we know this is going to be an amazing journey. So, with that being said, I will jump right into Monday's show, and we had a lot happening this week, so don't want to waste any time getting into this. So first I'll just give like a little, we'll get into who was on Monday's show, just a little background. The show started out with, we had some Marge and Sammy scenes where Marge visited Sammy in her jail cell. Then we had some EJ, Kayla, and Justin scenes in the courtroom. Race and Nicole scenes as well, where Nicole visited Rafe in his hospital room. Teresa and JJ scenes in the park, where they had a little little discussion, so to speak. We also had some Jennifer and Brady scenes at Jennifer's house about Kristen. Mason, Eric, and Daniel scenes in Mason's private investigator office with, with this Susan-esque impersonation of Kristen. Kristen locked herself in the bathroom, as we saw from Friday's show. We had some scenes with Bev and Rory and that guy, whoever, we don't know his name, I don't believe. Anyways, he's crushing on Bev, by the way. We also had some Ann and Teresa scenes and Jen and Teresa scenes. Teresa was running back into work, of course, late. I mean, I guess it's a surprise that she even showed up in the first place. We also had some Kristen and Brady scenes after Kristen escaped from that office and got home. Kristen and Brady had some scenes together. Nicole wanted to talk with Daniel, so we had some Nicole and Daniel scenes that talked about JJ. EJ and Sammy scenes as well. Jennifer went to visit Ray, so we had some Jennifer and Ray scenes. Nicole visited Brady at the pub and wanted to talk about Eric. We also had Kristen and Eric scenes. And we also had the show ended with Marge and Justin, where Marge confronted Justin with some news that carried into Tuesday's show, and this we'll get into. So, with that being said, what I want to focus on for Monday's show are the Marge and Sammy scenes, as well as the Rafe scene. So, we will get right into this with the beginning of Monday's show. So, Monday's show began with Marge visiting Sammy's jail cell. And I think I'll just go down the line here with how it happened in chronological order. I'm not going to go by storyline. I'm just going to go by the Marge and Sammy and Rafe scene. So after Marge visited Sammy in jail, we switched to the Rafe scene. Rafe had a dream. He recalled his meeting with Marge, which was, I believe, that was the week before. And when he woke up, Nicole was there. I remember back, I believe it was last summer. I think it was back last summer was when Nicole and Daniel were, like, wouldn't say an item, but Nicole was sleeping with Daniel, correct?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And I think she, like, confided in Rafe a few times. Mm-hmm. And I remember back then I thought Nicole and Rafe would make a great pair. I don't think they make a great pair now. I think they just as friends, but I think the interaction between them is going great.
Mm-hmm. I like to see them together. Like
really?
As friends, yeah.
Okay.
They cracked me up.
Yeah. No, that, that's true. They are very funny together. I mean, I don't really have a problem with Rafe and Kate, but, I mean, I don't know. Nicole and Rafe, Rafe and Kate, I don't know. Kate's kind of getting on my nerves with all this, the delicate flower or something like that. I mean, he's perfectly capable of, well, I don't want to get into that because that was later in the week. I'll just get right back into Monday's show because we're kind of off track. Anyways, Nicole and Rafe scenes. Nicole tells Rafe that she couldn't stand to lose him. I can't remember the running line that she had. I'm not sure if this is later on the show and if I have this written down. But I remember that she said that she couldn't stand to lose her friends, all two of them. I just thought that was hilarious. I can't remember if that was later on or if that was here and I started writing it down. But she said she couldn't stand losing her friends, all two of them, which was Rafe and Eric. So anyways, Nicole tells Rafe that she couldn't stand losing. Then they discuss Sammy. Rafe wants to talk with Sammy. But, of course, you know, Nicole, not the biggest Sammy fan. Nicole says that she doesn't think that's a good thing right now. He should be glad that he got rid of her. Of course, it would be difficult anyways, considering Rafe is unable to move and Sammy is in lockup, so that's pretty much impossible anyway. I think this is what Nicole said. Nicole said this about Sammy. Nicole said that everything she touches goes straight to hell. I can't really disagree with that statement. I mean, she got a point, but... I that quote was just kind of funny from Nicole. I mean, what isn't funny coming from Nicole? She always has these hilarious one-liners.
I know, she does. Her and Victor, the best.
were you watching days, you probably were, you're a longer fan than I was, but were you watching days when Nicole and Victor were together?
Yes.
What did you think of it?
That made for some good entertainment. I knew that they weren't going to be together because she was just in it for the money. So
she kind of like Teresa,
right?
getting back into the Marge and Sammy scene. I cannot get over her name, Marge. It's like, who is she? Is she like from the 1800s or something? Marge. You don't hear many people named Marge these days. But I digress. she says to Sammy, well, I believe she reached into a purse, if I remember right. Marge reached into a purse, and Sammy was kind of, she kind of pulled back. And Marge said, do you think every woman carries a gun in their purse? I cannot stand Marge, but that was hilarious.
It was.
But she reached into her purse to give Sammy a picture of Timmy, which we all know is Marge and Joseph Bernardi. Child. She wanted to give the picture to Sammy to remind her of what she has done, what she has taken away from this innocent child. Marge asked Sammy, why did she hate him so much? I'm really looking forward to the day that Marge finds out the entire truth about who Bernardi is. Not sure when that's going to be and if that's ever going to come out, but I'm just really getting sick. I want Marge to get off her high horse is basically what I'm trying to get at. She thinks that Bernardi was this perfect husband, innocent all around, nothing, no quirks about him. He was just this perfect husband. Little does she know. And no matter what you say, she's not going to believe you, but I don't know. I hope Justin does his job well. Marge. I think, yeah, there's more Marge and Sammy scene. Oh, this was great. This was really rich. Marge and Sammy, he's still continuing to talk. Marge says that, this talking about her late husband, says that Bernardi, get this, listen, Bernardi was a decorated hero. Now, if that doesn't make you laugh, I don't know what will. and was getting ready to go into a friend of his going into his hospital room to cut it off. But he's a decorated hero, everybody. Bernardi's a decorated hero. So just put that twirl around in your mind. Marge takes the picture of Timmy back because she doesn't think that Sammy deserves it and she says she hopes that Sammy never sees her kids again, which is kind of harsh.
I wanted to punch her.
Sammy could take her. Sammy could so take her if she was outside of that jail cell.
Yeah, definitely.
Sorry, guys, I haven't been looking through the chat room, but Travis says that Marge needs to go find the nut house that. And then Christina says that she did in Salem. Travis says that Jennifer's mom can help her ease into her new wardrobe and habitat. I'm not sure what that's about. I don't know.
Jennifer's mom used to be in the nut house. Laura.
Oh, Laura. Okay. Okay. I was a little thrown off track there. Let's see. I finished. She took the picture back of Timmy. I'll bite my tongue on this. I'll move into more Nicole and Rafe. Nicole tells Rafe that Sammy needs to stay gone. Nicole says. Then Nicole wants to talk about Eric. I can't remember exactly what she's saying about Eric, but she is she's basically, in a sense, she's talking nice about him. I think she's defending him too, right?
Mm-hmm.
And as Nicole is doing that, Rafe is smiling at her, and Rafe says, "Obviously, you care about Eric, really care." Of course, Nicole just I believe she rolled her eyes or something to that effect. Nicole continues to defend Eric to Rafe, and then Rafe just begins to laugh. Nicole says, in reference to Eric, she says that it's none of my business about what's going on with Eric. And when I'm talking about Eric, Nicole was talking about his health issue, which was, when he was drugged by Kristen, and he has these where he faints and he's lightheaded and everything. Kristen or Nicole says that it's none of my business. And then Ray replied to her saying, "Well, it never stopped you before." And Nicole says, that's true.
They're funny when they're on screen together.
I know. It's just hilarious. Oh, my. I keep wanting to say Kristen. I don't know why. I keep wanting to say Kristen. Probably because I just love her so much that I could just talk about her all the time. But I'm not going to talk about Kristen on Monday's show. But she did have a huge part in the show on Monday, as I mentioned earlier. So Marge has left Sammy's jail cell, and EJ has come. Sammy's a little frightened when EJ arrives because of what Marge has said to her and just by her actions. She thought that Marge was going to kill her. I'm sorry, I shouldn't be laughing at that, but I did. Sammy mentions that she survived death row once, and she doesn't know if she can do it again. And I'm glad the writers brought that up, that they didn't forget that piece of history when Sammy was on death row all them years ago. So that was good of the writers to bring that up and, connect the history to this present story. So I believe Nicole has left Rafe's room by this point, and she went to go find Brady to discuss Eric. But I want to discuss more about the Rafe scene, because Rafe had another visitor that day, Jennifer. Jennifer visited Rafe. Rafe talks about how he's talking about Daniel, and he mentions how often Daniel comes to see him and how great of a doctor he is. And I think that Rafe says that Jennifer is lucky to have a man like him in her life. And then, because when Jennifer went in there, she was kind of This was, at this point, Jennifer was not, she wasn't really thinking about, I mean, she was, you know, broken up with Daniel at this point. And she was, you know, focused on JJ. And to me, I felt like that she has already forgotten about Daniel. But after this visit with Rafe, Jennifer says, talks with Rafe and says that she is lucky to have him in his life. And she has forgotten that, so to speak. Rafe has made Jen realize how lucky she is to have Daniel in her life. She jumps up from the chair and runs out of the hospital to go find her. I don't know if Daniel's in the hospital, but she runs to go find Daniel to talk to him. Marge is walking through the town square. I thought that was the name of Marge, but it's not. Marge is walking through the town square, and she gets a text. And I know she barely had time to look at her phone. She barely had time before she said, "No way in hell," and she ran off. She did not have time to see what that text said before she said, "No way in hell." I know. I could tell. But she just knew, was reading her line, and she didn't even take time to look at that phone. Anyways, you all know how much we don't like Marge. Now, I think I speak for the rest of us when no one likes Marge.
Definitely not.
Dawn says that they had to cut the commercial. Yeah, that's what it was. She had to hurry up and get her line in before the commercial came. So EJ and Sammy in the jail, EJ tells Sammy that you could be home free. I believe I forgot to mention this earlier, but they got the permit to exhume Bernardi's body. And this is what EJ was telling Sammy, was that she could be home free if they get the body exhumed and they can prove that the bullet isn't what killed him. And, you know, Sammy's spirits are uplifted at this point. But EJ soon thereafter gets a call from Justin. He got the call from Justin I got ahead of myself. And he told him that he got the court order to exhume Bernardi's body. Sorry, everybody, got ahead of myself. So Justin calls the cemetery after he hangs up with Eric. He calls the cemetery and tells him that he has a court order to exhume the body. And this is when Marge shows up. And Marge says it is never going to happen. Of course, we don't know what she means by this and how she can stop it. But on Tuesday show, we see why she says that this is never going to happen. So that is all I have that I wanted to discuss in depth with on Monday show. I wanted to look through here and see if I had any, like, one-liners that I wanted to mention that I didn't. I think that is all I have. There's a Teresa line, and I can't remember if it was this episode or if it was Wednesday. She says that she wanted some blow, which was just so cracked me up. I don't know if that was Wednesday show or this show. Anyways, that is all I have for Monday's show. I wasn't expecting to take 20 minutes for that. Wow. Okay, so anything that you wanted to add to Monday's show?
No, you covered Monday.
Okay.
I was just angry at Marge on Monday. So
I think the rest of the day stands for.
Yeah. All right, so on Tuesday they had Teresa and JJ and Jennifer and Nick and Daniel, I think, was on here. And then also there was EJ and Sammy talking and Justin and Marge. And then there was Nicole and Brady and Kristen and Eric and Steph. So I'm going to go and start with Teresa and JJ and that storyline. So Teresa, I believe she asked JJ to come and meet her because I think at the end of Monday maybe he was planning a date with Bev because he saw that other guy, I forget his name, making a move. But then she went over to him, and so he asked her on a date. So at the beginning of Tuesday, he got that call.
Bev was going to have a Twilight marathon in her basement.
Yes.
And that was going to be their date. But JJ said they were going to find a party.
I was like, uh-oh, Twilight and Days, my two favorite things. But anyway, so it starts out, she's asking him to come meet him, and he's reluctant because he's looking at Bev, and he's like, do I want to ditch her for Teresa or not? Like, you could tell he had that look on his face. So he decides that he'll go and meet her. But he tells Babs that he's got to get permission from his mom before they can go out. So, and let's see.
Got permission from mommy.
And while JJ is on his way, I guess Teresa runs into Nick. And she sees that, I guess, she bumps into him. Well, before that, I think Nick was on a phone call about an interview, and I think they just hung up on him or something. It didn't sound too good. So when he's going in the town square and she's in the town square, they bump into each other, and she knocks his briefcase over, and papers fall out, and she sees that he's a stockbroker or in the stock exchange. And so the gold digger that she is, they have some coffee and talk about the exciting world that is stock exchange. I was like, really? Okay. So now I know that she likes the rich guys, Daniel, and she thought she was rich. So that's why I'm like, she's a gold digger, definitely. Which I don't blame her, I guess. But as they walk away, JJ's just standing there like, really? You know, he's just like, obviously, you wanted to meet with me. He had that, you know, that kind of a sad puppy dog look on his face. He was devastated. And so I think that he just goes over to her and is like, oh, really? You want to get with Nick? And then he sees that she thinks that he's rich. And so he's like, oh, you think he's rich, huh? Or something like that. And he was like, really? Well, he's my cousin, and he went to jail for murder. After stalking a woman, and then that he had married the first woman and that he married the first woman he met when he got out of prison, and now he's going to have to owe her alimony for his wife and baby once the marriage was annulled. And she's just like,
in the chat room office, Nick doesn't have a thought to this in. That's so true.
And Teresa just looks like disgusted, and then
she was like scared
at her. She was kind of like, what am I doing now? And then maybe she had asked for him to help her, I think, get out of the coffee date or whatever. Uh-huh. And he's like, oh, don't call me or text me ever again. And he leaves. And then let's see, my notes are going crazy. Oh, Nick comes back, and she's just like, I think she just goes ballistic on him and screams something about, you're broke or something like that, and you're a broke ex-con loser, and said something later, poodle, or something like that.
I think she said, don't try to turn this around on me, poodle.
Yeah, that's what it was. And Nick's like, poodle. He was like, what? But I laughed out loud so hard at that because I thought that was hilarious. I'm like, where did poodle even come from? I don't know. But anyway, I just thought that was hilarious. Okay, sorry. That was like the funniest part of Tuesday, I think. But okay, so anyway. So Jennifer, like you said, for Monday, she left Ray's hospital room and was going looking for Daniel. And so she shows up, I think, at the Kiriakis mansion. And as soon as he opens the door, she pretty much, like, jumps on him, starts kissing him. And and he's like, maybe we should find a more private place. Because they're, like, right there in the foyer or whatever that's called.
With the door wide open, too.
I know, with the door wide open. So they leave and go to Daniel's apartment, and they did the dirty. And that was a little bit more than I wanted to see of Daniel and Jennifer. I was like, oh, dear, this is a little bit much.
The majority of dates, even though I may not be in the majority myself, but you do speak for the majority of dates fans.
No, don't get me wrong. I do like Jennifer. I just didn't like those little facial expressions he was making. He was a little bit too into that.
Well, I'm not sure how to put this, but I mean, they were kind of graphic. I mean, they were,
yes.
It really made it seem like they were, I mean, Jennifer was like, just finish your notes. I don't know where I was going to go with that.
It was like, it was crazy. So I'm sitting there like, oh dear, where's the fast forward button? But so anyway, sorry. So Daniel, I think maybe he'd asked her when they were all done what had changed or whatever. And she just said that she'd realized that she didn't want to risk losing him and that she couldn't stay away for another day or even another hour. That's one of my little quotes that I took from that thing. Lord help me. And then she told him that she loved him and would never take him for granted again. So meanwhile, Maxine sees her at the hospital and she greets her with a handful of messages and also told her that JJ was waiting for her in her office. And she was looking through the messages and she was like, oh my gosh, I won the PR award. And Maxine was like, yay, congratulations, and gave her a big hug. And Daniel sees them, and of course he thinks that they're talking about them getting back together. So when Jennifer left, Daniel came over to ask Maxine what they were talking about. And she said that she was so happy about the news. And then when she said something about she was pleased that it wasn't the woman from the nearby hospital, I forgot
the
what
Barracuda.
Name.
Barracuda. Barracuda from St. Mary's.
St. Mary's, thank you. He was like, his face just looked really confused, and he did not know what she was talking about. And so,
I was actually confused at first. I was like, who wants St. Mary's and who's the Barracuda? I was thinking, is she talking about Chloe? Because I thought Maxine already said that they were back together.
Well, I was thinking, what? And then I thought, okay, she's talking about that PR word. Got it. So I guess it was between Jennifer and then that other lady. So Jennifer won. Of
and,
course she did.
Oh,
I mean, hello. Jennifer Horton. So, but anyway, the last part of this scene with them was Jennifer agreed to JJ in her office, and he noticed that she was really happy and wanted to know why she was in such a good mood. Mm-hmm. No, he doesn't want to know. Trust me. And then, let's see. I don't know which one I want to talk about. Do you want to talk about EJ and them? Yes, I do. I'll go in a little bit about Brady and them. But so EJ was telling Sammy. I have to pick my EJ and me scene, of course. So EJ told Sammy that Justin has secured an order to examine the body of Bernardi. And Sammy had told him about how she was worried that Marge was there earlier bothering her. And he just assured her that she would be safe in the cell. And then his phone rang. And I thought it was going to be Justin, but he handed the phone to Sammy, and it was Johnny. Oh, he's like the cutest kid ever. He's probably my favorite.
Sitting on the bench in the middle of the square all by himself.
I know. That's what I was like, where's Marlena? Like, or somebody, whoever was supposed to be with him. Caroline, I don't know. But yeah, he was all alone.
I think he was sitting right outside the pub, I think is what it looked like.
Yeah, so he was probably,
watching from
Caroline.
The window.
Yeah. But I thought that same thing, because I was like, seriously, where? Why is he by himself? But anyway, she was very happy to hear him, and he wanted to know when she was coming home. And then she said soon, and she told him that he was in charge of the hugging and kissing of his brothers and sisters. Oh, or his sisters and brother. I just thought that was really sweet. I was like, oh. And then she broke down in, like, tears, and then Ethan was like, okay, that probably wasn't a good thing. But she was like, no, it was, and that she was happy. And Sammy asked EJ what the new date of their wedding should be. And then EJ said that he had never canceled their wedding plans because he has faith that she will be cleared. And
it's not looking too good right now.
I know. But she said something like, this wedding will be the last, best, most important one. Okay. So Marge, the evil lady, she confronted Justin about the plans to exhume her husband's body. And he explained that he had a court order and that it was going to happen, and that he had requested it because there was evidence that the shooting wasn't the actual cause of his death. Well, Marge had demanded justice. She was like, justice will be served, and Sammy shot my husband, and was like going crazy. And then Justin promised.
May I interject here for a moment?
Yes.
And if she, and Marge, I'm going to be talking about Marge, of course. If, where is her kid? Why is she just spending so much time in Salem trying to get revenge for her husband's death? Shouldn't she be spending time with her son, you know, trying to comfort him over the loss of his father instead of
Exactly.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And I was wondering,
okay,
because
you.
I never mentioned any more family, so I'm always thinking, where mm-hmm. is he? Where do you have this
Caroline's
child?
Caroline's probably watching
sad.
Him for all we know.
You're probably right. So what does all the kids in Salem? For free! Okay, sorry.
Exactly.
So, Justin has said that there would be justice if they could find the truth about what really killed her husband. And she said that she was like grinning or something and told Justin that there would be no exhumation. I can't say that word. Because she had ordered him to be cremated to save money. And so she laughed.
Talk about
and
no,
she's just so evil. But she says she wanted to see the look on Sammy's face when she learned that he had been cremated. So when she left, Justin was on the phone and he was like trying to figure out what really happened. And he found out that, sure enough, he was really cremated. So then he called EJ and informed him of the bad news. And let's see. I think EJ had said something about that he was worried that there might have been a cover-up. And Justin said that he believed Marge had cremated her on legitimate reasons and not for a cover-up. And then Sammy broke down and was crying, and EJ told her of the cremation, or when EJ told her of the cremation. So, yeah, that does not look good for Sammy at all. And I'm anxious to see what lies ahead there. But also on Tuesday, Nicole asked Brady for a favor. She wanted to know more about Eric, and Brady was like, why don't you ask Eric yourself? And she said, because they're not really talking right now. And then he asked her if he was aware of her feelings for him, and she had mentioned that EJ had told him about, made a comment about it that raised suspicions. And then Brady had told her that Eric wouldn't judge her. And then, meanwhile, Kristen is under the desk looking for her bracelet that fell off. Eric comes in and sees her and asks what she's doing down there. And she's actually telling the truth, except for she did more than just drop the check off. She was on that computer looking for that PI's information when she lost her bracelet. But she said that she dropped it there when she was dropping off the check. And then, let's see. I think Nicole shows up while Kristen is still there, and then Eric, you know, looking at her like he's upset, and so she thought it was about the whole Sammy situation, and actually he's thinking that it was about Brady because Kristen had told him that they were sleeping together. And then I think that was it. Kristen went back to the mansion, and Father Matt showed up and wanted her to fix the kids, and she had screamed out something like, the last thing I need to do is spend more time with Father Eric. And that's what all that happened on Tuesday.
Well, I think I've mentioned it before on previous shows. Marge, I just have this feeling, this strong feeling that she has some kind of connection to Stefano.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know why. How'd she know? When Marge got that text, who'd she get that from? How'd she know that they were going to exhume the body? I mean, why would someone text her and not call her if it was something that important? So she's got some kind of connection that we don't know about.
Right.
Christine in the chat room says, remember Stefano laughing on the phone? Right when they decided to exhume the body, he has to be behind it somehow. Exactly.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I mean, and she was so determined to make Sammy pay. It seems like she would want to really find out what happened to her husband. So I do think that, too. That's crazy.
Huh. And I hear the actress is on recurring until November. So she's not going away anytime soon, sad to say. So with that being said, we'll jump into Wednesdays. A lot happened again on Wednesday. See, some of the scenes that we had Jen and JJ scenes, as Misty mentioned. JJ went to go visit Jen at the hospital. I won't be getting more into that in depth with those. We also had Maxine and Daniel scenes, which Misty mentioned, or I don't think you did. No, you mentioned Maxine and Jennifer. Daniel came into the hospital after the Jennifer and Maxine scenes, and they had a little misunderstanding with their discussion. We also had some Maggie and Will scenes. Will was in the park doing some homework, and Maggie came by, and they talked about how he's doing, how Ari's doing, how his relationship is with Will, with Sonny. Of course, we know that Maggie would want to know that. Maggie wants to know everything.
Maggie's
Maggie has to know everything about you know, everyone's business except her own. Eric and Nicole. Sorry guys, I'm trying to multitask here. We had some Eric and Nicole scenes. I believe this is when Eric confronted Nicole about sleeping with Brady. We also had some Kristen and Brady scenes. Father Matt came over to visit them. I'm going to discuss those more in depth. Teresa and Caroline scenes. Teresa went to the pub, and I'm not good at multitasking. I'm sorry. Teresa went to the pub, and she had a little tiff, so to speak, with her grandmother. And her grandmother called her Stephanie, by the way. I guess that she said that's how she gets when she gets heated. And Stephanie is Kayla's daughter, I believe. Right?
Stephanie, yes. Mm-hmm.
Uh-huh. Okay.
Yeah. Stephen and Kayla's daughter. Oh, no. And then they have to play that sad music.
The Teresa and Caroline scenes?
Yes. I was like, aw.
Oh. sorry for the message. I'm trying to talk, do two things here at once. Let's see, Daniel and Jennifer scenes, I'm going to get into those more in depth. Kristen and Dr. Chica scenes, I'm going to get more in depth with those. Kristen and Eric, Maxine and Jen, and Kristen and Nicole. So I want to focus on Wednesday shows, Jennifer and Kristen scenes. But the last few scenes, we had Father Matt and Eric had a few scenes together. Daniel and Teresa, a few scenes where Daniel gave the symphony tickets to Teresa. Teresa thought she was going to go on a date with him. And we ended, we had some Brady and Maggie scenes where Brady told Maggie that he was back with Kristen. That didn't go too well. So, let me see here. I think I will discuss the JJ and Jennifer scenes. So, JJ catches Jennifer in a good mood because she and Dr. Dan had just had some afternoon delight, so to speak. I guess that's the best way to put it. Let me see. What can I say about Jennifer? I will say that her hair was very nice after that afternoon session. Her hair was looking pretty gorgeous after that. I mean, how'd she do that?
I don't know. She's been dressing a lot better for a few weeks. Her little sexy dresses, and she doesn't look like a grandma.
Yeah, that's true. It's about time. I think the wardrobe department has focused more on Jennifer and less on Adrian, because Adrian's wardrobe, whoa. Kristen tells, I want to get into, like I said, I wanted to focus on the Jennifer and Kristen scenes for Wednesday, August 7th show. Kristen tells Father Matt, and Brady's in the room as well, Kristen tells Father Matt that she cannot spend more time with Eric because Father Matt has said that Bishop White has ordered, well, would like, I'm sorry, guys, would like, I am so jumbled this evening. Bishop White would like Kristen to help select the scholarship recipient for the New School St. Luke's Academy. And she says that she cannot do it. And Brady isn't sure what to think about this, and neither is Father Matt. Jen tells JJ that she can see that he's changing, which I'm not sure who she's looking at, but evidently she's not looking at the same person that the rest of the day's viewers are looking at. JJ says that he is going to see Will, which I believe this was like two weeks ago. He said that I believe on Wednesday or Thursday he was going to go see him, and it took him till Wednesday of this week to go see him. He said that he's going to go see Will, and then he gets a phone call from Teresa. And he ignores it. He said it was just a telemarketer. More Kristen. Kristen says that tells Father Matt that she'll think about it after Brady talked to her. She says she says, working closely with Eric is complicated. Yeah, that's one way of putting it. Kristen, again, Kristen and Brady, Father Matt has left at this point. Kristen and Brady discuss the scholarship, being on the committee to select scholars for the scholarships. Kristen tries her best to get out of this, saying why she can't work with Eric and she can't do this. But Brady says that, because I believe Kristen mentioned something that it would be hard for Marlena. She says that she doesn't know how Kristen or how Eric is going to tell Marlena about this. But Brady says that she is going to do it. She's going to work with Eric. I guess Brady has final say. And when he said this, Kristen said, did you get a PhD in optimism when I wasn't looking? I don't think Brady has a PhD in anything, but that was pretty funny. JJ and Jennifer scene, JJ asks if he can go out tonight. Of course, you know, Jennifer asked if he had homework done and everything, and she was like, of course, she assumes that there is a girl, and there is, it's Bev, as you all know. Brady has a PhD in sexy hotness. Dawn. And I'm sure Misty agrees with that as well.
Yeah.
but this girl that, you know, JJ is wanting to go out with, Bev, and Jen wants to meet her, you know, just like any mother would want to meet the girl because, well, in Jennifer's case, she wants to make sure that she's not too old. She's not some 40-year-old or whatever. Because as we know, the last girl that JJ brought home was a little too old for him. I mean, we don't really know. I don't think we know for sure how old Teresa is. Do we? I don't think we do.
I don't either. She's in her 20s, I think.
Yeah. Okay. We are so behind. Oh, my gosh. Kristen, or... Daniel, after JJ left, Jennifer agreed to let JJ go out with Bev as long as JJ brings Bev by the house. So JJ left to go see Will. Daniel, after his talk with Maxine, goes to see Jen. He has a question for Jen. Daniel wonders why Jennifer hasn't said anything about them getting back together. He says, are we back together at all? I mean, she doesn't have to be shouting from the rooftop, but, I mean, later on we'll find out more. So Kristen was getting ready to go meet with Eric talk about the scholarships and everything, but she called somebody before she left. We weren't sure who it was at this point, but we soon found out. Daniel and Jennifer have a little bickering session. Daniel says, was today a one-time thing, a hit and run? Jennifer says, that reference hit and run is kind of funny to me. Jennifer,
it is pretty funny. Oh god! And now hearing
Jennifer
it again,
says,
is even more funny.
Jennifer says that she's in love and she is committed to Daniel, but she is afraid to go too far into this because JJ is making progress. And when they were together, JJ was not making progress. I mean, I guess her first priority should be her son, but she shouldn't let JJ dictate her relationships. Daniel tells Jennifer that after more bickering back and forth and whatever, Daniel wants to focus on them, wants to focus on he and Jennifer. He doesn't want to talk about JJ. Jennifer says that he needs more time and JJ needs more time. But she doesn't want to end things with Daniel. That's the thing. She doesn't want to end it. She just wants, Daniel says that you can't have it both ways. But she says that we can. We just have to keep it a secret. We could have secret dates and stolen kisses. I don't know how romantic that is. It doesn't sound that romantic to me. And of course, Daniel will not agree to this, which props to him. Daniel, I was having a hard time of who to choose, if Daniel and Jennifer, whose side to be on. But I love Jennifer, but Daniel's right, I believe. I want to say that he deserves better. I mean, maybe that's going a little too far, but he can't wait around forever is basically what I'm saying. So anyways, the person that Kristen called was Dr. Chaika. He's still around. He comes over to the Mirror Mansion, and Kristen wants to know if Eric is going to remember what happened. And he says that if he hasn't remembered by this point, it is all gone. He says Eric will not remember anything since he hasn't remembered yet. Kristen then heads to the church, and she asks about how Marlene will take the news, and Eric says that she will understand because it's for the children. They shake on it. They shake hands, Eric and Kristen, and then Eric is kind of frozen, so to speak. And did he have a flashback? I don't think he had a flashback. I think he was just kind of frozen at this point. He just, like, taken aback, so to speak.
He did have a flashback, yeah.
Yeah. He got a text from his from Grandma. Grandma Caroline texted him. Didn't know she knew how to text, and she had a phone. But Eric had taken her to the pharmacy earlier, and Caroline had said that she left her prescription in his car, so he had to take the prescription over there. Eric leaves. And Nicole entered after Eric had left. And Nicole said, what the hell are you doing here? And Kristen just kind of rolled her eyes. So back to Jen, Maxine entered, and Maxine says, do you have something you'd like to share with your good old buddy?
Jennifer said, I love Maxine.
She's so hilarious. I mean, a lot of people are not liking her right now because she's so, like, she's pushing Dannifer. She's like a Dannifer shipper. I mean, that's why.
Oh,
so,
she's precious. I love her.
I know. She's the best. I'm glad that we're seeing more of her. I kind of wish she had a bigger storyline, but.
I know.
Maybe
she'll hook her up with Abe. Or Roman.
I mean, have a triangle, or a square with Abe and Roman and Kayla and Maxine. How about that? I don't know. I'm delirious. last thing, the show ended of Kristen and Nicole. Nicole asked her what she's doing here, and Kristen says that she is her new boss. And that is how it ended. Yeah. Okay, so that is all I have for Wednesday's show. Yeah.
Okay.
So.
All right. Thursday, I have a lot, but I'm going to try to shorten it down some because it's a lot. So, but on Thursday, let's see. Rafe, of course, is in the hospital, and they start talking about the case, and then Adrian and Justin and everything. And I'll probably talk more about that one and more about Marlena, Kristen, Brady, and them. So, let's get started.
Yay.
I'll start with Rafe. I think he was actually, I don't know, he was like staring at his arm or trying to move his arm or something.
Yeah.
And I didn't realize that he couldn't move his arms. I just thought he had problems with his legs.
Anyway. I don't think he could move from the neck down if you.
Oh, crap.
I think.
Okay. Have I been? I've not been paying attention. I just thought he was just laying there because it's Galen, and he was just talking. But anyway, so apparently he's paralyzed from the neck down. Awesome.
So we're laughing at a man being paralyzed here. Listen to us.
I know it's awful. I love him. Like, I know there's a lot of people that don't like him, but I like Rafe.
Mm-hmm.
Anyway, just not with Sammy. So Justin enters the room and asks him how he's doing or whatever, and he says something like he wants to walk. And Justin is like, well, how about you try moving your arms first before you try to walk? Which I was like, dang, Justin. But he wondered if he could ask Rafe some questions about Bernardi. And then Kate comes in, and I'm sitting here thinking, Kate, are you his mom or his girlfriend? What are you doing? Because she immediately, like, jumps all over Justin telling him, no, get out of here. And then, of course, Rafe's like, I can answer a few questions. So,
He can make his own decisions.
I know. And Rafe looked annoyed with her, I thought.
Mm-hmm.
I thought,
he was.
Okay, you're pushing him away, so keep it up. So he asked him about his relationship with Bernardi. And I think he said that they had a working relationship and they were all right, but other than that, he didn't see him outside of work. And he couldn't recall anything that ever made him a suspect of being a dirty cop. And he's like, so I'm not really helping Sammy's trial, am I? And but he also said that Sammy wouldn't have shot Bernardi unless she had a good reason to do so. So let's see. Kayla. Adrian comes to see Kayla, and she wants somebody to understand why she did what she did. She was doing it to protect Sonny. She didn't want him to be in trouble. And at first, Kayla was like, no, I don't understand what you did. Kind of, you know, not being supportive of her or whatever. And but Adrian has said that the video would have eventually surfaced anyway. The police would have found it, and then Sonny would have gone down with it. But she's paying for her actions now because Justin hasn't said a single word to her since the day Sammy was arrested. And then she asked Kayla what would she have done if they had asked Stephanie to commit a crime. And so then Kayla said she didn't know what she...
Shout out this week.
I know. I wonder if they're going to bring her back.
Bring her back or something?
I don't know. Maybe. but I wonder if it'll be the same one. I don't know.
Shelley Hennig, I think, is a better name.
I don't know.
I think that was who the previous actress was.
Yeah, the one with the brown hair, because the one before her had red hair.
Yeah.
I don't know. I can't remember what her real name was. It's horrible. But I did like her. but anyway, Kayla said she didn't know what she would have done. And then... Eventually, Kayla said that she did understand why Adrian made that decision, because I guess she was thinking about, you know, what if it was Stephanie? She probably would have done the same thing. And so she was relieved to hear someone finally admit that they understood why she did that. And Kayla brought up the book club at Jennifer's house later that she would have some more friends or whatever, and she was like, no, I can't go to that. And but she urged her to, you know, she wanted her to come to the book club. And then here comes Kate barging in, announcing that Justin was badgering Rafe, which is not true. He was not badgering him at all.
He was not. He couldn't have been more calm with him. And
I
Rafe
know.
Was completely calm as well.
I was like, really, Kate? Calm down. But anyway, so of course, here they go, running off after him. And at that point, Rafe was kind of getting a little bit agitated because I think he wanted to know more about the video and what their argument was about, but Justin wouldn't tell him. So his blood pressure was raised, I think, like 4 points or something to him. It was like 135 over 8.
I think that wasn't normal.
Yeah. I'm like, it's not that high, but whatever. So they, let's see. Sorry, I got sidetracked with my notes. Kate gave her the list of resumes and letter recommendations for the therapist that she wanted them to use for Rafe. And then Kayla, I think, told her that it had to stay between them because that was a teaching hospital and it was state-funded. So I guess if anything got out about that, it could cause problems with their funding. I think she had mentioned that before when Kate had brought this whole situation up. But
I was confused on that. I didn't understand what that was about. I mean, yeah. I don't understand all the medical stuff and state funding, whatever, but okay.
Because, right. I mean, if they're a real physical therapist, why would it matter? But anyway, it's not like they're bringing in somebody crooked. I don't know. So anyway, that confused me a little bit because I was like, whatever. But she convinced her that they're the best physical therapist out there and that they can even use them for other people in the hospital, but race had to be a priority. So Kate comes back to Rafe's room and told him that she wanted him to talk to her about his feelings instead of pretending to be brave. And so he, you know, blurted out that he can barely move his arms, can't move the rest of his body at all. You know, what if he never walks again? So he was confiding in her about how he was really feeling. And but she told him that she was going to have the best physical therapist that he could have come in. So meanwhile, Kayla is in there looking at over the staff, and she sees Jordan Ridgway. I think that's what her last name was. She thought that she would probably be the best that stood out the most to her, so she called somebody and discussed getting her the position. And
Kate's going to say sorry.
No. Same, same, same. I see a new love triangle. So Adrian wanted to talk to Justin, and he said that, or I think she said something about, can you spare a few minutes to talk to me? And he was like, no, I don't have much time. Clock's a ticking. And so she was like, you know, we need to talk about our marriage, and insisted that they talk about it. And he was like, well, this isn't the place. So they leave, get in the elevator, and it looked kind of awkward in the elevator. They weren't saying anything at all. And I think that they ended up going to the town square to talk.
I was reading the chat room, and Christina says that Kate is worried that Race Magic Stick won't work anymore.
Shameful. But probably right. Uh-huh. That's hilarious. Oh, my gosh. Now I really can't think, because that is too funny. Oh, my goodness. Magic Stick. I like that. Okay. So let's see. Adrian was getting mad because Justin wasn't engaged in our conversation. And he just said that he hadn't gone anywhere yet, except for that he had moved out of the Kiriakis mansion. And then Adrian, he told Adrian that she knew exactly where she could find him if she decided to make a drastic decision without confiding with him first. And he made it seem like she didn't want their marriage to work. Because I guess she didn't confide in him with evidence. She didn't trust him enough to go to him first.
All right.
And then he said that he would never put work above his family. And then she's like, you did. Maybe you didn't realize what you've done, but it happened because of who you're in bed with at work. Now how long are you going to punish me for being right? And I think at some point he yelled at her. She was like, don't talk to me like that. And then by the end of it, they're both yelling at each other. And I'm just like, oh, my gosh. So
that's so unjust and Adrian-like. I mean,
I know.
Stable couple normally.
Yeah. Yeah. And then she said something about he's in EJ's pocket, and he gets mad and says that they're done. And she wants to know if they're done with the conversation or done with their marriage. And that's it on that storyline. So let's move right on into Marlena. Marlena was asleep on the couch, and she's like, John, in her sleep. She opens her eyes, Chris and Seven over, and it's like, oh, Marlena, this is so sad. John's not coming back because he's done with you. I, however, am just getting started. And so she wakes up, realizes she was having a nightmare. Brady runs into Eric, who doesn't want to talk to him. And at first, Brady doesn't understand why. And then Eric goes ahead and tells him that he knows about Nicole and him having sex. And he said that how could he do that to her and not think about her feelings? And he was like, well, she kicked me to the curb a couple of times when I was in love with her. And then he was like, well, Nicole's really upset about what happened. So Brady promised to talk to her later. And let's see. Meanwhile, Marlena shows up. And she greets Eric warmly and Brady. And Eric's like, I need to leave, but Brady has something that he wants to share with you. And so she's looking confused or whatever. And then Brady told Marlena that he's back with Kristen. And she is just like, what? Are you crazy? And she had a funny line at some point about being thrown in a fire and his stubs were going to get charred. Or you're going to come out with charred stubs or something like that. And I was like, oh, my gosh. Okay. So, anyway, I thought that was pretty funny because I'm like, of all the things to say, you say charged steps. Okay. So, anyway, Nicole starts laughing hysterically when Kristen claimed that she was her new boss. And then she said, yeah, we'll see how much you're laughing when you find out that that's true. Which I was kind of surprised by that because she's not really Nicole's boss. I mean, she's just working
with
Eric because of kids. So, but anyway. Nicole said one of her mini one-liners because they had found out that she actually was working there. She was like, Bishop White wants you near children, many of whom who haven't had their shots yet. And that's pretty funny. So Kristen vowed to, or Nicole vowed to stop Kristen, who had already ruined Brady's life, and she wasn't going to ruin Eric's life. And she said, oh, it's too late for that. And so then Nicole was kind of like, what do you mean by that? And then she says she hasn't had a chance to ruin Eric's life because Nicole has already done that or is attempting to do that or something like that. And then I can't remember. My notes are horrible. I'm sorry. Let's see. Kristen insists that Nicole meant absolutely nothing to Brady. But Nicole doubted that Kristen would have warned Nicole to stay away from him if Kristen had truly believed that. Kristen smiled because she could see that Nicole didn't seem to view her as a threat. And so I think she asked her, or she said something about, you're not afraid of me, are you? And she was like, no. And she was like, well, you should be. Nicole gloated that Brady had had ditched her, and it wasn't even, I forget how long she said, but a few days or not even a few hours before he actually jumped in bed with her. And then Kristen said that no one would ever be able to stop her. And then she noticed that changed Nicole's expression. So I guess she thought that her threats were finally getting to Nicole. And then she says, you have no idea what I'm capable of. And then...
Is this when she, made that biting motion with her teeth? She, bit?
Yes!
So I think it was Shark Week last week. I bet that's why they did that.
Oh, that's hilarious. Yes, she did that then, of course. And then at that time, Eric comes in and sees them talking or whatever. And then Nicole slammed the stack of applications that Kristen handed her because she wanted her to put them in alphabetical order, I believe. And so she handed them to her. She was like, put them in alphabetical order and by grade or something like that. And so she just slammed those down on the desk. And she was mad that they actually had her asked her to help with the church. And then she said, I'm sorry, God or Jesus or whoever has this place wired. And I hate her. And then...
God or Jesus or whoever.
Yeah. And I think Eric asked her if she hated her for simply because of who she was or because she was with Brady. And that kind of made Nicole just stand there and look at him like, what? You know, because really...
Mm-hmm.
He doesn't know, of course, that she wants him,
right.
But so she's having to play this off that she's hurt by Brady and Kristen. So,
I mean, I can't believe he doesn't know. I mean, Eric is that clueless that he cannot see what Nicole is feeling. I mean, I don't know why.
I mean, she has to be completely crazy to not notice that because, I mean, she looks at him and how she acts is just completely, you can tell that she loves him.
Mm-hmm.
But then at the end of this story, I think Kristen puts that flash drive of the video of her seducing Eric in her purse and says she'll keep that until she's absolutely certain she no longer needs it. And Brady called and Marlene, and I guess he was trying to warn her about Marlena, and then Marlena knocked on the door. And that is how Thursday ended. Also, on Thursday, they had, Chad, Abigail, and Cameron.
So I'm going to get into that, I think, on Friday show.
Okay.
Because there's some big developments there with that.
Yes.
It's 8 o'clock right now. So are you still good to go? I'm going to try to get here as fast as possible. I believe we have a caller on the line. I believe... I'm going to get through Friday's show, and then I think we'll bring the caller on after I finish with Friday's show. That's okay. I should have brought them on earlier so they could discuss with us, but we'll just go with how this, see how this goes here. So after I finish Friday's show, we'll bring on the caller. So Friday's show, the interactions that we had were EJ and Will. EJ went over to Will's place, Will and Sonny's place, and with Ari. The scenes I'm going to discuss more in depth are the scene, the Sammy scenes, and the Adrian scenes. Yep. Okay. So the interactions that we had on Friday were EJ and Will and Ari, Sonny and Sammy, Justin and Adrian. We had some Abby and Cameron named their park, having a picnic, lunch, whatever. Chad went to visit his doctor, and he got the results, a definite answers to his scan, brain scan. We had some hilarious Victor scenes with Brady. Victor basically blasting Brady for getting back with Kristen. I wish I would have written down everything that he said, because he's just hilarious. But I didn't get down much that he said.
One thing I got was Vivian was evil, or Vivian was something, but Kristen was, oh, dang it. I had it on the tip of my tongue, now I forgot it. But it was hilarious. Pretty much, oh, deranged.
Yes,
Vivian was evil, but Kristen is deranged or something like that.
That's it. can't really disagree there. I kind of wish they'd bring, if Eileen and Kristen's leaving, they should bring back, they need a dark female character. I don't know if they're going to plan on making Teresa that, but, I mean, they need someone, like, bring back Vivian or, I don't know, Vivian's the best one I can think of. We also had the Marlene and Kristen scenes. There was a cat fight there, Marlene and Kristen at the mansion. Marlena called Kristen a bitch, and Kristen says that she loves it when she plays rough.
That was hilarious, her choking her.
I'm sad that Brady had to come in and break it up.
So hard. I know.
Sonny went to visit Adrian. EJ came to jail to visit Sammy. Brady and Kristen scenes, as I said, Brady came in to break up the catfight between Marlena and Kristen. And Brady and Kristen had a little confrontation that ended up with them doing it on the chess table. After Brady left Victor's house, Justin had an encounter with Victor. Justin's living at a club. He's not living at a club. We don't know what club. He's living at a club, and he hasn't seen Victor in over a month. Victor said that normally he's not the one that he worries about. I mean, he says that Adrian is acting more like a curious man than you are. that was kind of a low blow. Abby went to visit Will. This girl, she's got problems. Oh, I feel so sorry for her. Chad and Cameron, and then Marlena and Sammy. So like I said, I want to discuss the Will scene, the Sammy scene, and the Adrian scene. So EJ went to visit Will, and EJ took a video of Will with Ari to give to Sammy. Meanwhile, Sonny went to go visit Sammy in jail. Sammy's in there doing, I had push-ups, but I think she was doing crunches while she was doing sit-ups or whatever. And Sonny blames himself for Sammy being behind bars. We switch back to Justin and Adrian in the park arguing still, and he says that he's done. And she asks if he's done with the marriage or if he's done with this conversation. He says that he's upset that she didn't confide in him with this. I'm trying to see both sides of this with Justin and Adrian. Adrian, she did attempt. I mean, I'll give her credit. She did attempt to confide in Justin, but I don't think she tried hard enough. I mean, she could have tried harder, but she didn't. So I do kind of fault her for that. But I mean, she did try. I mean, Justin wouldn't listen, and neither would Sonny. No one would listen to her. I don't know really who. I don't know. I just, it's hard. Adrian's necklaces make me not like her. anyways, that's kind of shallow. So Justin says that he just needs time to process all of this. Justin kind of screams at her, and Adrian is like, I cannot believe that you took that tone of voice with me. Which, I mean, it just made me laugh because, I mean, couples fight and scream all the time. I find it hard to believe that Justin has never screamed at her. I mean, and Adrian screamed at him. She screamed right back in his face. So she's just a hypocrite.
They had a screaming match.
Mm-hmm, they did. It continued for quite a while. Adrian is upset. Well, obviously she's upset. And she cannot Adrian is upset, and Justin, he cannot believe that Adrian pushed Sonny and himself away like that. Let me get this straight. Justin can't believe that Adrian pushed he and Sonny away. I feel like I said that wrong again. Anyways, you get the point. back in jail, Sammy tells Sonny that he is not to blame and he cannot blame himself for this. It's not his fault. And it's not. It's not his fault. If anyone's to blame, it's Will. But, I mean, I wouldn't place any blame on Will either. I mean, if Will would have came forward back when, this would have been an issue. But he didn't. I mean, he was a child. I don't blame Will. I'm not saying that he should be blamed. Don't start attacking me with attack tweets that saying it's all Will's fault. But, I mean, if anyone's to blame, it'd be Will over Sonny. But, like I said, I don't blame Will. Sammy had a quote here. She says that Will loves you, and so do I. Which I thought, oh, that was just so sweet. How do I go on from there? This will jump into Will's scenes where he's still feeling guilty. I'm talking with EJ. He still feels guilty that his mom is in jail. He feels this is his fault because he didn't come forward with what he did all the years ago. EJ said that if he did, it would have given his mother more motive to attack Bernardi, and it would have looked worse, or it would have made her case even worse than what it already is. Will then has the recollection of working with EJ, you know, I believe that was early last summer. He said that EJ was a pain in the ass, but he's glad that he's like that now. He knows that this kind of attitude is what is going to help free his mother from jail. Back at the jail, Sammy tells Sonny that he needs to convince Will that this is not his fault. And Sonny says that that's going to be hard. And I believe Sonny might have said that. I'm not sure, so I won't go into that. But and then Sammy tells Sonny that he cannot lose this relationship with his mother because Adrian would have done the same thing if she was in Sammy's shoes, is basically what Sammy said. Adrian and Justin continue to scream in the park. Adrian, these things were very good. Give Judy a mini. Adrian says that she's not the bad guy for doing this. She doesn't regret protecting her son. She doesn't think this is fair at all. Switch back to, Adrian has left. Adrian left after this. So we see Sonny in the square, and he went to go see Adrian. Adrian was in the square. Said that Sammy, hear this often, Sonny said, Sammy is right. She's your mother. He said this to himself. So he walks over to see her. EJ went to the jail. EJ and Sammy kiss. Sammy says that she wants to jump his bones. I can only imagine what you were thinking at this point. Sammy mentions that Eric and Caroline had been by this morning, and so is Sonny. Sammy says how great a guy Sonny is, and EJ says, well, speaking of another great guy, and he had the video for Sammy, and he showed Sammy the video of Will with Ari. She's so cute, that baby, the cutest baby ever, and she's so good, she never cries. Most babies on soaps always cry. I've never heard her cry. She must have been an actress out of the womb. Well, I think it's twins that play her, I believe. Adrian is in the square, sitting at the table, bawling her eyes out. As Sonny approaches her, Adrian looked a little surprised that Sonny had approached her. She asked how Ari is. But she really wanted, what was really on her mind was Justin. She told Tony that she's afraid he's going to lose him from what she had done. EJ has promised, EJ tells Sammy that he promised Will that he was going to get Sammy free. He says the truth will come out. So back at the Will and Sonny and Gabby's place, he's there, and she says, have you ever been in love with you at the same time? Abby says it's to Will. And she says, who am I kidding? Of course you have. And this kind of, I kind of laughed at this because Will's situation was, what his situation was, is nothing like what Abby is going through right now. If you ask me, I don't think Will was ever really in love with Gabby. I don't want to sound mean, but I don't think he ever really was in love with Gabby. He wanted to be in love with her, but he wasn't.
As a friend, or like he loved her,
right.
But he wasn't in love with her, yeah.
Well put. Mm-hmm. And Abby making that assumption. This chick.
I know, it was funny. I was like,
it's not the same situation, honey. It's all right, but it's not. And then, of course, well, she didn't say that it was Gabby and Sonny, but Will said, oh, you mean Gabby and Sonny. He says it's not the dumb thing. I knew that I belonged with Sonny. And Abby was like, oh, I'm so jealous that you knew that or something, because, you know, Abby cannot make up her mind, going back and forth between two guys. So Will tells Abby that this doesn't sound like the biggest problem in the world. And it's not. She's got this. Abby is slowly driving me up the wall. I like Jennifer more than I like Abby. And if you asked me a year ago, I would have thought, if you told me that I would like Jennifer more than Abby, I would have thought that you were crazy. But right now, yeah, I kind of actually like Jennifer more than Abby. Abby is driving me nuts. Make up your mind. Well, I mean, she might not have to now with the news that we found out on the show. Which is kind of mean, but I'll get into that. Adrian says that she's paying for what she has done. She says that she doesn't really want to talk about Justin. She doesn't want to talk about Justin with Sonny. She wants to talk about Sonny. She says, how's everything with Will? How's Will doing? Has Ari smiled at you or something like that? She says that it's the little things that she wants to know about, and she worries that she's not going to be able to talk about them things with Sonny anymore. But Sonny says that he's going to forgive her, and the waterworks kind of stopped there for a few seconds, but then they started up all again, and she started bawling again. I'm trying to be nice to Adrian. I really am. I'm sorry, but it doesn't come easy to me. Marlena comes by the jail to see Sammy. EJ has to leave, so he heads out. This is a quote here I have. Sammy says that the more time I spend in here, the more I think that I'm never getting out. I think a lot of the fans are thinking that, too. Sonny comes back to Will, seeing Abby had left. I believe we didn't see her leave, but she had left, evidently. Will was standing over Ari's little bassinet thing, and then Sonny came home, and he looked like he was kind of tired or something. He said he's happy to be home, and Will says he missed him, and that's how that ended. I wasn't really picking Sonny's hair, by the way. Sonny and Adrian had pretty much matching hair on Friday show. but we're not a discussion show about that. You know, that's what we normally talk about a lot of the people, what they wear and everything. But anyways, I digress. Marlene tells Sammy that there is no end to their power. And when she said they're talking about Demir. Well, we all know that Marlene is not a big Demir fan, but in this case with EJ, she knows that EJ will do anything, go to the ends of the earth to protect her. So I guess you could say Marlene is team EJ. and then the end of Friday's show, EJ says that there's a mysterious man that we don't know who's talking to. Well, he is there, but we don't know his name. We saw him for the first time. He tells this man that you're going to make sure that the police can't prove – you're going to make sure the police can prove it. Now I look back at that, I'm not sure if that's exactly how it was. But anyways, he called this man to help him prove that Bernardi was a crooked cop, I believe is what he called him for.
Mm-hmm.
And I believe that was it. But what I forgot to mention was the Chad scene. Like I said earlier, Chad had visited his doctor, and the doctor's office that Chad's doctor was in is the same office that Mason, the PI, was in. It's the same office. I swear it is. If you go to the college, just look. I swear it's the same office. Anyways, he got the results, and then he left, and he was looking kind of distressed as he left. And then we didn't see him again until later on. But he met with Cameron in the pub, and Cameron wanted to know what was wrong with him, if there was anything wrong with him, what the results showed. And he says that this has to be between us because I don't want any pity. And Cameron is kind of, he's not sure what to say, like, what's going on. And Chad says that I don't want any pity on me because I'm dying. He has a brain tumor. So it seems as though Chad is going to be exiting just like his sister did. I'm not sure because I thought they had recasted Chad. I don't know, maybe, I mean, I don't know how, if brain tumors are curable. I mean, I don't know if they, I don't know. But Casey is leaving, but I have a feeling that they have that they recasted him. I'm not sure, you know. They taped 4 months in advance, so it'll be a while before we know. So that was all I had for Friday's show. And that is all we have for the week of August 5th. So I believe we had a caller on the line, wanted to discuss Dave. I really wish I would have brought this in earlier instead of right at the end of the show so they could have discussed with us. Sorry, everybody. But I believe we have a caller on the line, so I believe we will take them now and see what they have to say about last week's shows. Caller, are you there?
Yes, hello. My name is Harrison, and I just wanted to say my favorite scene of the week, I loved the Kristen and Marlena catfight. It reminded me of Crystal and Alexis from the Dynasty days.
Oh, wow. You're going way back there.
Yeah. I just think it was just hilarious. I love the relationship. Their adversarial relationship.
Yeah. They were my favorite scene this week, too.
Mm-hmm. I just hope when Chandler Massey leaves, they recast, because I think this storyline is too good and too groundbreaking just to pause.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I agree with that. But I believe there was Chandler Massey did an interview with, I don't know, SoapDome.com, one of the soap websites, and he said, this was, I believe, last week or 2 weeks ago, he said that no decision has been made yet, even though it sounded like at the Emmys, you know, he gave that speech afterwards in the press room, and he said that he was leaving. But according to his interview from a few weeks ago, he has not decided. Now, I don't know, maybe he's trying to cover up that he is leaving. We don't know. I mean, like we said, even if he does leave, he'll be airing into April. But,
He'll be on for a long time. And I believe Dave's tapes a long time in advance, so Eileen Davidson,
yep.
I think I read, she'll be on screen until at least November.
Mm-hmm, that's correct, yep.
So I'm glad she'll be around for a while.
Mm-hmm, we agree. We got to have Kristen. I mean, I think Kristen has, Eileen Davidson, I think she has almost single-handedly revitalized Dave and brought him to where they are today.
And I loved her line during that fight with Marlene. I think I'm not sure if I got this right. She said, "I've been with all of the men in your life," or something to paraphrase that.
I'm in bed with all the men in your life. Uh-huh.
Yes. She brings the comedy to the show.
It's terrific. I'm so glad that they snatched her up after Y&R fired her. Yeah. She's going to be so missed when she leaves.
Well, that's about it. I'm glad I got a chance to talk to you guys.
Yes, thank you for calling us.
Thank you so much for
y'all
calling.
Y'all have a nice
you
night. Bye.
You too.
Thank you. I'm so glad we had a caller. I think that was like the first time we've ever had a caller.
It is. And I think you said his name was Harrison, right? I hope he called.
Yeah, Harrison.
Yay!
I know. So nice. So, you want to get into your spoilers and casting. Okay.
Yes. I didn't have any new casting from last week. I tried to find some stuff, but I couldn't find anything other than what we had talked about last week. But I do have spoilers, of course. So, the week of August 12th, Sammy's life is threatened in prison. And I think it was Christina in the chat room that said it's probably Timmy plotting to go after Sammy. So it's probably him who's threatening Sammy's life. Just kidding. EJ plays dirty to clear his fiance's name. Excuse me. EJ plays dirty to clear his fiance's name. So that'll be fun. I love when EJ, the Demira comes out in EJ. JJ freaks when he realizes his special donuts got switched with the ones for his mother's book club meeting. So not realizing they're high, Hope, Jennifer, and company have an interesting afternoon, and Julie ends up in handcuffs.
Oh, my gosh, that's going to be hilarious.
Oh, my God, that's going to be
hilarious. I heard Julie's going to be back as well.
Yay! Will's insecurities about Brent boil over, and he finally confronts him.
Eric's finally get a backbone.
I know. Eric sees Kristen in a new light, and Kristen is caught red-handed by Brady. So I don't know if that means with that video or something else. Sammy and Kate stumble upon the truth behind Stefano's actions. And then Kristen tells Jennifer that she may be pregnant, and someone comes close to uncovering her secrets. Dun, dun, dun.
Oh, my gosh. I cannot wait for that, for Kristen, the pregnancy thing, the storyline. Who knows how that'll go, because we all know that Days doesn't have a track record with babies, you know. I mean,
right.
How many babies has Cole lost?
and they have
one
a
last
track
thing
record,
that I want to mention.
Track record of getting women pregnant who can't get pregnant. They have a track record of that, too.
Speaking of pregnancies, one last thing I want to mention before I close the show. I think you all remember Christy Clark, Carrie,
yes.
Days of Our Lives.
Yes.
I'm still hoping. I still want that cafe baby, but I know I'm never going to get it. I was a huge Rafe and Carrie fan back when Carrie was still on. Probably one of the few. But anyways, I'm going to give up on that because that's probably never going to happen. So like I said, Christy Clark, ex-Carrie, Days of Our Lives. She and her husband have welcomed their third daughter, Charlotte Joy, last week. She was born August 6th, and she is the third member of the Clark Barnes clan. She has two other sisters, Hannah, who is five, who is two. So congratulations, Christy, on the new addition to the family. Hope to see you back in Days soon, but, you know, probably won't be. You know, she's got a newborn baby. But, so congratulations.
She is so sweet. I've talked to her on a couple of the other blog radio shows, and she's just so sweet.
I hated to see her leave. Of course, I guess good that she did leave with Austin, you know, for all the Carrie and Austin.
And
but,
they haven't even, didn't she leave pregnant from the show? Wasn't she pregnant? I wonder what ever happened to that baby.
Yeah, because she thought it was going to be Raves, but I think they took a test, and it was proven to be Austin's. Of course, we all know how paternity tests and soaps go. I mean, we all know how those mesh together. Not very well. I mean,
right. But you think she would have the baby by now?
Yeah, I'm sure she did. She would have.
You think Marlena would have mentioned it? Like she would have called Marlena, but I guess they're just completely leaving them off the story.
Yeah,
which is fine. I'm just trying to think.
I can't remember. Yeah. I thought maybe that they mentioned it. I thought maybe Will mentioned it about.
Oh, did they?
Maybe not. I don't know. Oh. I can't remember. This might have been a few months ago, maybe. I don't have a good memory. But, yeah.
Me either. That's why I have to take notes. I'm just kidding. And I just watched these shows today.
So, let's see. I think one last thing was going to be that, but then here I go again. Next week, Misty will be doing Monday, Wednesday, and Friday shows, and then I will be doing Tuesday and Thursday and the spoilers and casting news. We decided that we're going to alternate this from now on. you know, every other week we're going to switch off on the shows that we do. Thought it'd be something different, you know, give me a break from doing 3 episodes a week. Yeah, I'm not complaining. I'm not complaining, but you know, now that classes are starting and everything, I want to be a little bit more busier. I don't. Nothing else is going to change with the show. So even with my classes starting, we'll still be doing shows on Sunday at 7 Eastern Standard Time, like always. So I'd like to close the show by saying thank you to everyone for joining us. And if you wanted to catch our past shows, those are on TalkShoe. So go to TalkShoe.com and type in Common Ground Radio, and you can download episodes 1 through 13 there. So, again, thank you for joining us, everybody. I hope you join us next week for our 2nd episode on Blog Talk Radio, Faith Talk. Yay. So, for Common Ground Radio, I'm Brandon.
I'm Misty.
Have a great week, everybody.
Good night.
You've been listening to Common Ground Radio with hosts Brandon and Misty on the Air Nation Radio Network. Thank you for joining us.